So we're back to this Birch test, right? So it failed the A because it wasn't automatic. We needed human. We were mucking around all the time with human experts. It passed the I test.
Right.
Because it became interpretable. This was a precise formula. Most importantly, it passed the N test. This is the first time that an N test was passed because it actually galvanized a field of study in number theory. Now there's a whole field called memorization phenomena.
Wow.
This is totally out of like, what the hell? I mean, this is above my pay grade because I don't know the number theory community that well at all. So that's why Quanta was so excited. You know, there were conferences organized in ICERM. There are all these people, there are workshops apparently in Bristol and various universities. They're like, oh yeah, there's this have a memorization a workshop on this. So I need to wrap up because I think it's getting too much detail. I want to tell you that there are other parts of this memorization thing. And now, but now you can conjecture, this is a precise conjecture. This is a precise conjecture that was raised by, guided by AI explorations with humans. And you know, Peter Sarnak says it really well. He says, this is a conjecture that Birch and Swinton Dyer could have raised themselves, but they didn't because they never thought to take this average. Because it's a bizarre thing to do. The AI doesn't know what it's doing. It always is doing this is spotting patterns. Hmm. So, and just to emphasize, parts of this conjecture now of the phenomena, which is expected to be true for all L functions. So this is why. So in other words, the memorization phenomenon should be a general phenomenon in the entire Langlands program. So it's now proven. For Dirichlet character, the memorization Dirichlet character has been now proved. So this memorization actually converges to a precise curve. And this was proven by, I wasn't involved in this because this you need actual, it was an actual number theory paper. And then Nina Zubrilina, who is Sarnak's PhD student, who was Sarnak's student, and then Alex Cohen, and now they proved it for way two modular forms as well. And this was all in 2023, in 2024, and there are more results being precisely proven. And what it really is, and this is it goes back to Gauss and to Riemann Zeta, is that this memorization fundamentally generalizes a bias in the distribution of primes. That's also quite striking. So this is an interesting fact. So Chebyshev noticed this factor before. So Chebyshev noticed, it's called the Chebyshev bias. If you take all primes, if you take primes and consider and find the remainder of these primes upon division by 4.
Okay.
You're going to get remainder either 1 or 3. Right, because you're modulo 4. And you would have thought that it's 50% 1 and 50% 3 in the large limit. But Chebyshev in the 19th century already noticed there's just a tiny bit of a bias towards 3 than 1.
Hmm.
And that was just a conjecture of his. And this is, again, mucking around with data, this Platonic data. Like, why is it the primes are more biased towards one of the ones upon division by 4? This is known as Chebyshev's bias. And this was proven, actually, by Sarnak and
Rubinstein?
Rubinstein in the 90s, but only conditional on the Riemann hypothesis being true.
Interesting, right?
There is this fundamental bias. So there's no unconditional proof of this, but it's conditional on the Riemann hypothesis that this is true. But this is what is interesting is that the memorization condition, the memorization phenomenon is a generalization of this Chebyshev bias to all of the L function world. So it's a generalization from prime biases to the biases in all L functions because there is this underlying oscillatory behavior. And that also has this deep relation with the BSD conjecture. So that's where this whole world, and that's why it passes I, it passes N. People are still working on it, but it doesn't pass A, because you know human expertise were constantly involved in interpreting and choosing PCA. Anyhow, to wrap up this whole story, well, where are we, right, in terms of mathematical conjectures, in formulating problems in this top-down guided mathematical discovery over the centuries? And I will say that, you know, in the 19th century, the eyes of Gauss were good enough to come up with this conjecture. By the 20th century, BST already needed a computer to come up with a groundbreaking conjecture.
Yeah.
And we are now just at the cusp, and that's why it's so exciting, that AI-guided human intuition led to this DeepMind paper and led to the memorization thing and this new, in a new matrix multiplication. So obviously where we're going is a combination of these three directions. And I mentioned earlier, you know, in these very rooms that I'm talking, that Faraday would have had the conversation with Maxwell in this room, about 150 years ago, our institute has devoted one of our four themes to this AI for mathematical degrees, because this is really a paradigm shift in terms of how science is done. So just to promise, this is the last slide. So what is the current state of the art? Where are we with this AI-guided thing? Now let's drop this human-guided intuition for the time being. AlphaGo2, DeepMind, has now reached silver medal. I think we had this long joke and discussion about how to beat the mind, the 16-year-old the 12-year-old Terry Tao. When you beat the 16-year-old Terry Tao, it's game over. That's a new age of scientific discovery. But we're making, like, these guys or this field, we as a field, we as a community, we're making progress every couple of months. It's so fast. It's exponentiating. The DARPA, the U.S. military thing, now that U.S. is defunding everything, but it will not defund military. So the military wing, the DARPA, which is the Defense Advanced Research Institute, I was just at a meeting with them 2 weeks ago, just launched EXP Math, where they literally are saying exponentiating mathematics. You can Google this. The EXP Math project that DARPA is funding now is how to benchmark proving accelerating mathematics by proving. But unfortunately, they're not funding in this AI-guided discovery area, which I think should be funded. And that's the way, combination of all these three directions. Anyhow, so that's AlphaGo2. AlphaProof, again, DeepMind, is on proving theorems at an almost research level. And I think we even joked last time that at the silver medal level, AlphaGo2 is high school level. AlphaProof is maybe college level, right? Mm-hmm. But this is the interesting one. I think this is very, just to wrap up, the Epoch AI Frontier Math Project, and you can Google this, and this is really on professional mathematical problems, the kind of problems you would give it to a colleague or to a researcher, a very advanced postdoc or graduate student, and they're benchmarking this now. In fact, I'm flying to Berkeley on Thursday to help. There's a whole team of us. We're flying in to benchmark their Tier 4 problems. And this is happening this weekend, actually. So as of December 2024, Epoch AI is capable of solving only 2% of advanced research level mathematical problems. But by March, they finished their tier 1 to tier 3 problems, and they gave this division of tier 1 to 3 problems, graduate level problems. You can go to this website to look how hard these problems are. And Terry Tao gave some problems, and Ken Ono, these are all really research problems. And I gave a problem to the Tier 4, which is about to appear. And they're still soliciting more. And just go to this link. You can just look. Oh my God, this is the kind of problem I would give to my research student, or to the kind of problems I would work on with a collaborator. Like, and that we would write papers about. And their gate and their benchmark is about 10 to 25% on tier 1 to 3. So once you, their next benchmark is tier 4. And tier 4 is so hard that, humans are not likely to solve it. Not because they're tricky, like, Olympiad problem, but because they're actual research level problems. And we're actually, together as a community, are attacking this kind of problems. So this is where the state of the art is. So in terms of where the future of mathematics is, I think I try to summarize in this picture So I'm using an old picture of Terry Tao because he's the best human mathematician. Uh-huh. And so where how would it go? So you would have literature, the corpus of literature from scientific papers. You would go back and forth where human and I would process it together and then use top-down mathematics to formulate conjectures from Platonic data of that's gathered from the literature, or process it directly from the literature and formulate the kind of problems. Once the problem is formulated, you would go to auto-formalization, where it's only a matter of time before the lean community gets it. By auto-formalization, I mean you take a math paper in LaTeX and just hit return, translate it to a lean format. We're very far from that right now, having conversations with Buzzard, not because of the technology is not there, but because there's not enough lean data to train a large language model on.
Interesting.
We only have millions of lines of lean so far available, just millions. We need billions in order to have, and it's millions of, these poor guys type in everything, right?
Yes.
So conjecture formulation to this auto-formalization, and then you go through and find pathways through Mathlib in this bottom-up approach, where you would have a combination of LLMs, and that would generate your proof. And then you will feed to the human, where the human would actually interpret what this is, and then go back to writing the paper with AI and feed it back to the literature. This loop, I think it's where we are already heading toward. It's not in the immediately foreseeable future that all of this is going to be automated, but what is remarkable is that this is within reach, and I can't put a date on it. Maybe 10 years, maybe 5 to 10 years, because at every single step of this, we are being helped by AI. Like for example, the memorization, which is taking available data formulating in this way. And already last week, I'm meeting people who are actually coming up with proof pathways by ChatGPT and then humanly verifying that. So this is the brave new world of mathematics. I mean, of theory, of new discovery. And we're so lucky to be in this age where AI has advanced enough where it could actually help us with genuine new discoveries.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives me a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high-quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toe listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.